Did you, sir, are you there?
Hello, Padmakshi. Padmakshi.
Sir.
Are you getting me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So we can start the proceedings, okay?
I think we should start. Yes, sir.
Right now, okay.
Am I audible?
Yeah, it is okay. Yeah.
Good morning, one and all present here. Myself, Dr. Padmakshi Kakuti, faculty in the Department of History, Dumduma College, Assam. On behalf of the organizing committee and the coordinator of this national webinar on mapping tradition museums in contemporary times, organized by the Department of History in association with the Internal Quality Assurance Cell, IQAC, Dumduma College, takes immense pleasure in welcoming you all here today. It's really overwhelming to see such an exhausting number of participants, and this has truly made me believe this current pandemic has not dampened the speed of learning, nor are we escaping the process of learning. Thank you all for being a part of us. But before moving on to the serious engagement, I'd like to put on record at the very outset the people who has constantly been guiding us. The principal of the college, Dr. Prakash Jyoti Borthapur, sir, for being our mentor throughout. Head of the Department of History, Madhuchya Mohanto, sir, for guiding us to hold a webinar of this kind. IQAC coordinator, Dr. Pranjit Saikia, sir, and the IQAC team for associating with us for the smooth conduct of the program on a virtual platform. Ms. Tinamuni Rajkumari, faculty in the Department of History and assistant coordinator of this webinar, for being my constant support. I'm indeed humbled to have received your cooperation at all times. Thank you. But before doing the formal start, I'd like to make some important announcements. I would request all participants, especially our dear students, to kindly mute their system during the entire session so that there is an easy flow of communication. That's thumb rule one. Second, keep your questions ready in the chat boxes. Once the deliberation is over by the seminar speaker and is open for discussion, we'll be taking up your queries. To obtain the certificates, we'll provide a feedback form in the last part of the webinar in the Zoom chat box as well as in the YouTube chat box. Therefore, this is a kind request to all the participants here to tune to the webinar till the end. We are also happy to inform you that we are streaming live on YouTube now. So those who are not being able to participate here in this platform can catch hold of the session parallelly. Lastly, kindly bear with us if any kind of technical discrepancies pop up during the course of the entire deliberation. I'm sure we all are acquainted with the topic of the webinar by now, and which we are going to deliberate. Indeed, a very fascinating area. Subject to the study of history is the interesting note on museums. Let us today explore how wonderful of communication a museum can be and what best we can do to preserve it. Now, with these words, I invite Mr. Madhuchya Mohanto, sir, to kindly deliver his welcome address to the August gathering. Please, sir.
Thank you, Padmasi. I feel honored to welcome all the respected research persons. Principals are invited, students, and my fellow colleagues for taking keen part in this significant webinar. I'm sure that you all will feel enriched with sufficient knowledge after completion of this webinar. In this aspect, I'd say that in 2011, a museum is established in Dumduma College, which has been taking active part in enriching the knowledge of museum. It helps our students and visitors to witness traditional dresses, ornaments of various tribes of Northeast, coins of ancient India, agricultural and hunting tools, musical instruments of various tribes of Assam. We are planning to enrich it more. I welcome you all once again to this webinar. Thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now I would like to request Honorable Principal Sir to kindly deliver the inaugural address and declare the session open. Please, sir.
Good morning to all of you. Respected resource person of this national webinar on mapping traditional museums in contemporary times. This is Avantika Parakar, the district museum officer, Jorhat district, government of Assam. Honorable vice principal of Dumduma College, Dr. Injumani Sharma, Mr. Mohanta, IQAC coordinator, Dr. Panjit Khoika, and other members of the IQAC of Dumduma College, all the faculty members of the department and college, and the webinar coordinator, Dr. Padmakshi Kakoti, and joint coordinator, Ms. Chinamani Rajkumari, and the fellow participants, and my dear friends. Very good morning to all of you. So I, on behalf of Dumduma College fraternity, welcome you all to this national webinar on mapping traditional museums in contemporary times, which is organized by Department of History, Dumduma College, in association with IQAC Dumduma College. So, first of all, what is a museum? So, basically, museum is the thing by the building. Yes, what I say it is an institution where in which the collection of just artifacts, other objects, historical, scientific, artistic, or cultural interests are stored and exhibited. So, there are different types of museums nowadays. You can say aquarium is also a museum, anthropological museums, art museum, botanical museum, children's museums, historical museums, military museums, then the science and technology museums. So many different types of museums are available nowadays. But the majority of the museums were independent, and it is not known that they exactly when these museums were opened, where they were located, what subjects they covered, etc. And we did not know whether the change has been made since the period of expansion. That is why mapping museum project has been conceived in response to this situation. By mapping, we will be able to know how the museums sector, particularly the independent museum sector, has changed since its inception. To discuss all these issues, we have invited Mrs. Avantika Parasar, she is the district museum officer, Jorhat district government of Assam. Definitely he will highlight all the pros and cons on these issues. We have very small and very good historical and cultural museums, as Dr. Madhudha Mohanta has already said, which is under the Department of History, where a good number of artifacts and various collections are stored and exhibited. If you can have any proper guidance from our respected resource person, Mrs. Avantika Parasar, then definitely we'll expand our museums and could be made a tourist center in near future. As discussed earlier with the program webinar coordinator, Dr. Padmakshi Kakoti, I came to know that Mrs. Parasar is going to organize a student internship program on this issue. I request Mrs. Parasar to take initiative on these issues so that our students will be benefited. I also invite to our respected resource person to our college to organize a workshop on these issues where students will be able to take participants. With these keywords, I once again welcome you all, and I declare this national webinar, which is organized by the Department of History in association with the IQAC Dumduma College, is open. I would like to request all of you be safe and healthy, wear masks, maintain Google Ski duty for social distancing, and please get vaccinated by all those who have taken part in this webinar. With these few words, I once again welcome you all to this webinar. It will be a very fruitful one, I hope. And I conclude. Thank you very much. Over to Padmakshi.
Thank you, sir. So sir has in a nutshell already mentioned about the benefits and the importance of having a museum in the community. Thank you, right. sir, for your enlightening speech. Now, I would like to give a short introduction, though that will be done by Ms. Tina. But well, to start with, we have with us a very young and talented museologist who is definitely going to encourage our young minds through her presentation, I'm sure about it. We can effectively know how museums can map the spaces of understanding our contemporary culture and our tradition. I personally believe this should be rather an effort to unfold the conceptual divides that has taken place between the physical and the virtual, the fixed and the mobile, and the closed and the open. Now to introduce our resource to the participants, I request the assistant coordinator, Ms. Tina Muni, to give a brief account of her professional as well as academic journey. Over to you, Tina.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, am I audible?
Yes.
Good morning, all of you present here. I feel privileged to introduce Mrs. Avantika Parasar to the gathering. A young and dynamic officer, Avantika Parasar is the district museum officer, Directorate of Museums, Jorhat, Assam. Simultaneously, she is in charge of Dibrugarh and Majuli Museum. She has been providing her service as the head of administration, and her activities include academic events, outreach programs, collection, management, etc. She did her master's in museology from National Museum Institute, New Delhi, in the year 2012. She has working experience at Indira Gandhi National Center for the Arts, New Delhi, an archival project of documentation for setting up an archive on numismatic at Restore Heritage, New Delhi, is at her credit. She has work experience at Naga Heritage Museum and Culture Center, Nagaland. She also worked as docent for visitors program at Rashtrapati Bhavan, New Delhi. Mrs. Parasar has completed two projects. First project was project of upgradation of the tribal museum, Nagaland, and another one is Sanogabhut Contemporary Inuit Art, an exhibition based on modern artwork of the Inuit people of Arctic Canada. And this was a joint collaboration of the National Museum and Canadian government. She is the recipient of Young Member Grant in 2018 under Committee for Education and Cultural Action. She is CA ICOM and Sahitya Sabha Research Fellowship of Assam 2019. So we hope all we all have a very fruitful interaction with her in the proceeding session. Now over to you, Padmakshi ma'am.
Thank you, Tina. Now, without wasting time, I'd like to invite our speaker, Mrs. Parasar, to start with her delivery. Hereby, I'm also requesting all to remain muted during the entire session. Kindly type your queries in the chat boxes. It's over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Padmakshi. And at the very beginning, actually, I would love to express my gratitude to Dumduma College for giving me the opportunity to speak about a topic which is very, not only professionally, but personally very dear to me, that is museum. And thank you so much to esteemed principal, sir, Prakash Chatipur Thakur, sir, Madhurja Mohanta, sir, and of course you, Padmakshi, ma'am, for all the communications and everything. And finally, Tina Moni, Tina Moni Rajkumari, for introducing me so well. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
I just hope that I'll do justice to the topic, and I'll just try to brief a little bit about what is actually museum. And because on the basis of the working experience of last 10 years, I have now started developing a feeling that people has got some discrepancies, like what actually museums are, what we perceive as a museum, and what the people perceive. There's a huge gap in between them. So I've just tried to cover up that gap. And secondly, a very basic question, like all our students, that can museums be a career opportunity? And how we can go ahead and we can develop our places and our state with the concept of museums? I'll just try to brief up all those points in my short speech. And at the very beginning, I will just love to, I just prefer to brief what is actually a museum, a definition of museum that has been like set up by the International Council of Museums, that is the apex body of museum. It's a part of UNESCO and it has got its head office in Paris. So what they perceive museums, how they perceive the museums. So there is a definition for it. This is a definition that has been set up by ICOM, International Council of Museums. And as per the definition, a museum is a non-profit permanent institution. I request to mute yourself as I have to mute the webinar.
As our honorable resource person is presenting, so I request all participants kindly to mute yourself as I have to remove you from the webinar.
I think it would be better to remove. I can go ahead. Okay, am I audible?
You are audible. Okay, but there are some disturbances.
Yeah, yeah.
Kindly mute yourself. Dear participants, kindly mute yourselves.
I think they are on the phone, so they can't hear our voice.
They are not audible.
I think I should go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. You can continue.
As per the definition set up by ICOM, a museum is a non-profit permanent institution in the service of society and its development open to the public, which acquires, conserves, researches, communicates, and exhibits the tangible and intangible heritage of humanity and its environment for the purpose of education, study, and enjoyment. So when we go to a museum, and when we ask people about what is your perception about a museum, the very common answer that we get, it is a storehouse, or like where we can see our old artifacts, old objects, they are stuffed inside the building, and that is a museum. But is that the real definition of a museum? As a museum professional, I very often ask that question to myself. Is that the definition of museum? Is that the purpose of a museum where they are set up? And so to answer to the questions that ICOM, International Council of Museums, have come up with this definition, which actually tries to sum up all the important components, functionaries, duties, and elements of a museum. As it says, it's a non-profit organization. And yes, in some museums, they're chargeable. You have to give a fixed amount for ticketing or like for some videography, photography, etc. But that is not for the personal profit of any organization or any building, but it is for the maintenance. Of course, it has to be permanent. It's not like that if it becomes temporary, it becomes an exhibition. It should be like whether it has got a building or like some web page or whatever, but it should have some permanent link to it. Then it's for the society. Not for the personal benefit of any person, of single person, or a single household, or a single community, but it's a service to the society, and the development of that particular society. That it's always open to the public. Of course, there should be in some museums, due to the security purpose, or maybe due to the fragility of the objects, there can be some restrictions that at one time some certain amount of people can go, or a huge crowd, a huge gathering, they are not permitted. But it's always open to the public, irrespective of sex or age, community, creed, etc. Then the main purposes of the museums are which acquires. It goes for, you know, excavation or like whatever, or some, we got some museums that some objects are there. The museum, the primary duty is to acquire, and then they have to in the same time conserve the objects. We have, as a museum professional, we have to ensure that those objects, they do not degrade further after coming to the possession of the museums. And if they fail to do so, it's the failure of the museum and the museum professionals. Then, along with the conservation comes the research part. But an object, when there no story is attached to it, no further, you know, information or some valuable information, the history is not associated with it, then it is a simple product, a simple object that we see lying in our house or whatever. But when we know that the behind the story, the behind story, or the importance, the historical significance, how old they are, and all those things comes out from the researches. And when when we know all those things, it becomes an important artifact that is an asset, a heritage commodity, a heritage product that becomes the identity of the nation, of the community. And again, after the researches, those findings, that gathered information that has to be communicated, either maybe some research, some exhibitions or like some PR activities, or maybe some research papers through, you know, print media, or maybe through some lecture, public lectures, or what activities are there. But those findings, important information, it has to be communicated to the people. And exhibits, of course, it's not like that we have got one permanent thing, one very important thing, and that becomes the personal property of the museum. No, that is absolutely not acceptable. And those has to be exhibited, because while museums actually gather, collect the objects for the benefit of the people, so it has to be exhibited. And apart from that, now there comes the question, what can be kept in a museum? And the answer, as the definition says, both tangible and intangible. We all know what is tangible. Those things we can see, we can touch, and we can feel that those are the tangible objects. Like we see the archaeological findings, some old textiles, numismatics, coins, manuscripts, all those things, they are tangible. And intangible. Intangible assets are those which we cannot see. But we can feel, we know about them, like our oral songs, or the knowledge behind the knowledge of our ancestral knowledges about the medicinal herbs or the practices, or like that. As for example, this is a pen. This pen is because we can see it, we can feel it. It is a tangible object. But the knowledge, like how this, you know, the pen operates, how it is manufactured, or you know how it is, how that ink, it has to be, like, you know, we have to insert the ink. All those things, that become the part of the intangible knowledge or the heritage. So both tangible and intangible, they can be part of the museum. And of course, finally, it's. The museums, they are for the purpose of education, study, and enjoyment. It's not like that we, only the history students will go and we will, you know, mug up the dates and everything, and we'll come up, we'll return back, and our museum journey is over. No, not at all. It has a purpose, and that purpose is not only study, but also enjoyment. Like, you know, exploring our past, exploring our, knowing about our ancestors. And when we come entirely, when an organization or maybe some, like, as you have said, you have a museum, small museum, when they, and either entirely or partially, say at the 70 to 80% fulfills all these conditions that has been mentioned in the, you know, definition, it becomes a museum. So that is how we museologists, or like, no, museologists prefer to see a museum. Along with that, now comes a very basic question, like we very, very often encounter. So what is the type, like how many museums are there? What can be a, like what we can collect for to develop a museum? The answer is each and everything, whatever you think is important. And to justify that my answer, I just would like to put forward few, you know, examples. Like there's a toilet museum in Delhi. That's called Sulab Toilet Museum. It is in Delhi, in Palmeria. Then there in Jodhpur, there's a broomstick museum that is called Jharu. That can you imagine that a jaru, which is a very, you know, insignificant part of a household, the people can have a museum on the jaru, or like the, you know, the toilet sink. In a toilet museum, you can see varieties of, like, you know, very varieties of toilet sinks. Those were still used, or those were used in our ancient past. So there's a museum on toilets also. Then again, there are museums on shoes, then bread. Then when, again, when I went to, in 2018, I went to Georgia as part of my fellowship, I encountered a wine museum. But where that because Georgia is a wine-rich country, so they have got a museum to depict their the history, how that wine came to that area, and that what is the traditional method to you know, manufacture to brew or wine, and those important ethnic materials or like traditional materials, all those things are kept in that particular wine museum, and it's a huge hit among the tourists. The tourists from all over the world come to see that particular wine museums in the Kakheti region. So we can also have a wine museum. Then in Assam also we have got Heritage Transport Museum. So museums can be made of anything and everything, but you should have a vision, and you should think that that particular artifact, that particular object has some significant story to speak. So in that way, we can develop a museum. Now, for developing a museum, of course, I'm saying right now, but it's not that easy. And to develop that museum, you should have some basic components, I'll say. So that is what is needed actually, a general knowledge, a vision that what you want to showcase in that museum. And then again, a space. But now after the COVID pandemic, when it's going on, we have seen that museums have come up with such interesting, you know, the concepts and some programs. Now even the space has not become a requirement. Now that internet is there, the web portals are there, and through the web links and virtually, the museums, like big museums, like Getty Museums, National Museums, that Indira Gandhi Rashtriya Manav Sangrahalaya in Bhopal, all of the museums have come up with such excellent programs. Even the space has not become a basic, it's of course the basic requirement, but not, it's not like that if we don't have a museum space, particular space, we cannot have a museum. So the new innovations are always coming up. Then of course we need few volunteers, we need people to work, and for that, if we have financial constraints, then we cannot have them employed people. So for that, we may need volunteers. And then last, and but not the least, comes the most important part of a museum initiative, that is the documentation. I'll speak about the documentation part, but now I'll just come to the practical aspect. Like, okay, that is the theory part. Can we have some museums developed on like what I have spoken a little while ago? So before that, I will just give a brief about my personal experience. So here, it is a Naga Heritage Museum and Research Center in Kohima, Nagaland. That was my first major project after I completed my master's. I became a museologist. So the history is like that. Like, there's a household, so they are Angami Naga. So they have got some money, and the person, the head of the family, he has some interest, so he just started collecting objects those he have seen in his family. So now the Naga families, they are changing, the Naga societies are changing in a transitional phase from the old to new. So he very often sees that some big wood panels those were used in their old houses, they have been like that lying around. So he started collecting objects. So while doing so, collecting one by one, one fine day he discovered that he has collected almost 6,000 very precious objects. So, and from that collection, from that very insignificant habit of collecting objects, came up this huge collection. And I think this is the largest collection associated with the Angami and the Konyak tribe in Nagaland. So here you can see those panels. These were some once upon a time, 100 or 200, 300 years ago, those were used in their houses. And then the Sanghor. So he just collected, and now they have become a museum object. So here you can see that we were 3-4 people. We have got this Naga lady, then these two, that old lady with a, you know, and a cloth in their head, and this guy, they are from the Naga tribe. So what we did, we communicated with them, we gathered knowledge about the use and the importance of the all the significance of the collection, and then we developed a museum. So here you can see a brief about how we do those yellow texts. They are actually called index card. So we, as a formality of the museum documentation, we attached all those index card to the objects, and it helped us in later part in identifying the collection. Then okay, now here is a glimpse of Indira Gandhi Rashtriya Manav Sangrahalaya, that is the Bhopal and Madhya Pradesh. This is the largest ethnographic museum, ethnography, that is the tribe study of the ethnic groups, ethnographic museum in India, and one of the most significant ethnographic museum in the world. So here, well, if anybody know about the Indira Gandhi Rashtriya Manav Sangrahalaya, that's very nice. But for those who doesn't know about this museum, like this museum is all about the tribal, the ethnographic lifestyle of India. So it is spread over a huge land, and here the objects are the household. Here you can see this is one traditional hut from Nagaland. Then this building, it is the only one kind left, and this building is a traditional traditional architecture of Himachal Pradesh. So what they did, that they, you know, the part, this Naga house, it was constructed in Bhopal only, but this particular house from Himachal, the broken parts were, you know, transferred to Bhopal. They were again restructured, and this house came up. So that is just an example of how broad that, you know, the scope or the concept of museums can be. That even a household, those who very the traditional architectures, even they can be component of museums. Now again, there is many people like friends from Northeast India, even all over India, Pan India, they know about that, you know, Hornbill Festival. So this Kisama Heritage Village is the place where this annual Hornbill Festival is held every year. So here again, this is actually a broad open air museum where you can see the traditional architecture, the traditional houses of the 17 or 19 Naga ethnic groups that it spread over a huge area. They have got their log drums, or like the traditional how that Naga warrior looks, or like, you know, how that front yard is decorated. All those things are depicted in a very beautiful way. And here in the second picture, you can see, of course, that is me with my colleagues from the museum. They can come, they can witness, they can touch the log drums or the other artifacts, they can use it, and they can feel that how the Naga persons, they use that Naga community, you know, used to play those beautiful log drums. So in that way, the museum experience, it becomes a very happy experience. And that is the process, that is the scope, like how the new and nowadays museum are coming up, they're developing up, and they're, you know, developing schemes and programs and different PR activities as per the requirement of the modern society. Now, this is the museum, this is a glimpse of the museum from Georgia, like Kakheti, when I went for my fellowship. This is again to develop, to speak about the constraint of space. So what happened, this particular museum is located in the Royal Courtyard. So it has got a very space constraint, not that much of space is there. So what they did, they developed the management developed an underground museum. So here you can see, this is the entry where that the gentleman with a white, you know, lower is standing. So this is the entry, and this is that huge mound, and behind that mound there's a beautiful two-story building where in the third picture you can see the galleries. And this picture is very dear to me because I can see the use of bamboo. Then, so this is my personal favorite picture of that entire museum. So now, as I have said, the documentation is a very important aspect of a museum. And in documentation, like I am very happy to know that Dumduma College has its own museum. So, ma'am, I will request you to, if possible, just very happy if I can render my service, you know, and we can have some activities Dumduma College when everything normalizes and everything opens up. But till then, ma'am, it's possible, it's very important to, you know, to have some documentation sheet. And this is a particular sample of a documentation sheet, how that we prefer we in museums we maintain. And here actually is, and if anybody needs, actually they can copy the participants, if they want, they can copy up the particulars. And if somebody wants in letter phase, they can, my email ID is there. If they write, then I can send, I can mail a copy of this documentation sheets. And here in museum, what is documentation? I'll just prefer to give a very small example. Like in a household, it very often it happens that, okay, that different things are required, and sometimes that we just suddenly say that, okay, that sugar is over, that, okay, rice is over. So what I have seen my mother doing that in a sheet of paper, she writes down everything that what is required, like we have to purchase this amount of rice or this amount of, you know, lentils or this amount of sugar tomorrow. So what's the benefit of writing then? If my mother is there, that's okay. She will brief us. Okay, these things, they are to be purchased. But if my mom, she has to go somewhere suddenly, and when there's a person going to the market, and there's no communication in between them, then what would happen? Okay, that person will probably, like, you know, half remember the list, or some things will be left out. And again, the second day, the person has again to go. But if that's a written list, like, okay, 5 kgs of rice, 2 kilo of lentils, or like 1 kilo of sugar, then even if my mom is not there in the house, then that person, maybe my father or me, when we go to the market, we can, you know, see the list, and then we can purchase the required amount. That is the same thing about the museums also. Now see, like just see the sculpture, wooden sculpture here I have shown. Okay, that was collected by XYZ person. He had that sculpture in his house, that is their personal possession. So he knows the entire details about, like, who crafted it, how it was crafted, what is the type of wood, what is the knowledge, what is the significance, how they were used, everything, what is its name in local language. So that person is acquainted with all the information. But suddenly, just after, and he gave it to the museum. Then what the museum professional did, okay, the museologist has appreciated the sculpture, and it kept in a closed cupboard without any kind of information. Now what happened, that maybe say after like 2-3 years, that XYZ person, he unfortunately expired. Now, if we now, after 2-3 years, when the person is permanently gone, if we have to know about the sculpture, the significance or use and everything, then how we will answer? We don't have any answer, because the concerned museologist, he forgot to, or like maybe intentionally or unintentionally, he or she, that lady or that gentleman, didn't document the associated information, or didn't bother to ask that guy. So as a result, this beautiful sculpture, even though it had a heritage story associated with it, it became no use to us. And it just remained as a single object. But if that museologist, if that person had, you know, documented, or like he has like kept a document of all the associated information after interviewing that XYZ person, then it would have become a very significant, a very important heritage property. And that is where documentation plays the most important part. And documentation, even though in museums we follow different procedures and everything, like general accession register, classified accession register, index card, color index card, movement register, we have to maintain different things. And those things are when, like, we can, it's not possible to explain, you know, each and everything here in the virtual platform. And if principal sir permits, and then if everything happens positively, then maybe if we can have some collaborative program with Dumduma College, then we can practically explain all those components. But before that, for even for Duma College, even for all those participants, if you want to start or some museum or a museum like organizations, then this sheet, it's a very basic sheet and it's very easy, where you just have to write down the basic information, basic elements like the accession number, that is a unique identity number we provide to each and every object in museums. Then a brief description to identify those objects. Then its type, whether it's a sculpture or it's a numismatic coin or a textile like that. Then what was its use? Then present location, where it is kept right now in the museum building. Then its size, height, breadth, and width. And then again, material. And if it's made of wood, then wood. If it's like kind of the copper or like, you know, if it's textile, then we can add cotton or silk. So all the materials, then its shape and color, what is the present color we see, and then mode of acquisition, like it was gifted or it was purchased or what, or like source or province, like where it was, where from where we acquired the object, like say from Nagaland, from Guwahati, from Tinsukia, Dumduma, so from where it came. And then what is its local name, like if it's a, suppose we have got a pen and then maybe I have got one manuscript with me, if this manuscript is manuscript is there, so what we call this is a tulapat or puti, that's in our local language, and it's a, you know, type, it's a Thai in Thai language, so in Thai language it's called parpet. So all those things that has to be like mentioned in the local source name. And now it's a condition, like what is the present condition, the part of it's broken or like, you know, one part is missing or like absolutely intact. So what is, whatever condition is it, we have to write it in details. Then of course, whenever an object comes to the museum, we should click a photograph, and the photo negative number, it has to be mentioned. And all these things can be acquired. I personally use that method, that with the 5 WH question, like the 5 WH questions, like what, where, when, who, why. If we ask the object or the person these 5 questions, then all this information, they can be gathered. And then here it's called index card. Again, if somebody wants, then I can make it personally. Now I'll just briefly say how we can again incorporate all those things. Like as for example in Dumduma. So Dumduma is a place of historical importance for Assam. Firstly, it was part of the Ahom rule. Then secondly, it is known for tea. Then thirdly, it has got beautiful, you know, natural inhabitants surrounding it. Then it's, you know, it's a border state it's a border state. So it has got ethnographic varieties. Then it has got association with Second World War and that coal mining, or like, you know, that China with that 1962 China war. So all those things are that what Dumduma makes famous. So thus Dumduma has huge potentiality of becoming museums. Like if that, it's, I'm very happy to know that Dumduma College has its own small museum. Don't say it's small. Museums are always important irrespective of its size and, you know, space and everything. So if the college authority, they can incorporate a plan and where the Dumduma College Museum can be epicenter, then the entire place can be developed as, you know, some tourist place, tourist project. And like what we have got some beautiful examples, like in Jorhat, in Titabor, there is a very beautiful museum have come up, Thengal Kosari Museum. So here we can see a combination of their agricultural heritage, their cultural heritage, and tourism. All those 3 things has been incorporated very professionally and as per museum standards. And as a result, that Thengal Kosari Museum has come up with a huge footfall every day. So thus, those things can be also planned out if Thengal Kosari can do, if Titabor can do, why not Dumduma? That is my question. And I just request, I will just request the Dumduma College Museum Authority to plan out, to come up with such plans to, you know, to showcase the heritage of Dumduma in not only in Assam, not only in India, in the world phenomenon, because Dumduma has got world significance also. So, and of internet is always there, so we can equally have some space like a museum buildings, and we can also come up with some virtual platforms, and in that way Dumduma College Museum has got a huge potentiality to, you know, to develop some museums. And again, for those students that I have seen, as it's organized by the history department, those students, I will just have one appeal, because time is now coming, it's like nearing to end, that if you love history and if you want to pursue a career in history, then don't restrict yourself only to the, you know, of course you can have some choices, but teaching is not the only career opportunity, or maybe the UPSC civils are not the only career opportunity for a history student. Now, several, you know, other subjects have come up, like archaeology, numismatic studies, museum, conservation, then manuscript studies, epigraphy studies, and cultural studies. All those things have come up. These things have got good career opportunities also. And if anybody need any kind of help in this regard, then I'll be very happy, you know, to provide my service. And my email ID is given in this PPT only. You can write to me and I'll be very happy to help you. And I just finally to conclude, this is in my museological career, this is the best, my personal favorite picture, because here what I am handling, what I am wearing, those were the ornaments of a Naga headhunter chieftain who used to wear all those ornaments 300 years ago. So here you can see me, that was his headgear with feathers, with bird feathers. Then this is a spear that was used, that was handled by him. It has got that, you know, furs of bear. Then this, you know, this necklace or whatever you say over my shoulder, that is made of the, you know, teeth of a Mithon. Methone is extensively used as a methane. Then this is a necklace made of the original hornbill heads. Those things are not advisable at present scenario, but of course they have got 300-400 years old. And again, you can see a necklace. It has got, you know, wooden boar, like wild boar teeth. So those were the ornaments, and I see, and those things, actually I'll say that this museological career, it is very exciting, it's very promising, and me personally, I enjoy each and every moment of being a museum professional. And if anybody wants to pick up the same professional, then I'll be very happy to help, and I promise you won't be disappointed. Thank you. And with that, I conclude my speech.
Thank you, Avantika. It was wonderful hearing you. Indeed, I personally feel it is quite necessary now to connect our students. In fact, I would also draw the attention of my fellow colleagues who are participants here from different colleges in Assam to come up with something like start a museum, but concept of a museum, you can always start. And this is actually the platform where we can move on and think beyond. It was really wonderful listening to you, drawing several insights into the topic. Indeed, museum is a space where we can connect with the community. It is a kind of harmonizing with the community. I'm sure on a serious note, we'll be interacting more with you. We'll be engaging more with you. Our Thank students you. Will be engaging with you. We hope we'll have a very good collaborative work with you. I'm sure our principal sir is definitely listening to us and he'll be happy to know about it. Yet, I would also say our students should not just choose the conventional mode of history. As you have said, we have so many options to explore. like museum science, numismatics. So it can be an alternative career as well. I feel so. And there is a regret, of course, I have, because I couldn't choose museology. I opted to study in Baroda, but I couldn't get through. And this was like where I have landed up now, going to the conventional mode, of course. But this is really nice to know.
Thank you. Thank so you many so things much.
Together. Like I'll say in a nutshell, you have connected the Arunachal, you have connected Nagaland, you have connected Mizoram to Bhopal. That was a long journey, and to Germany, of course. So this is wonderful listening to you. I'd just move on to the chat boxes. If there we have any questions for you. I don't see any. I'd be happy if you can elaborate on the questions if they have participants. Well, there is something from Amrita Bora, really very informative. First time I have heard about the choice. So since we do not have any questions from the participants, should we go to the next? Well, do we have any questions? I don't think so. So for us, Avantika, you're relieved, I guess, from the question answer part. But I would have been very happy if somebody would have asked something related to museums, because this is very interesting. It's quite interesting, the topic, I say. Moreover, it is quite interesting because we can always connect our past, right, through such institutions. So since we do not have, let's move on to the second part. So before going to end this program, I take the opportunity to invite IQAC coordinator, Dr. Pranjit Saikia, sir. Since he has been guiding us throughout, and we are associated with them, since IQAC is taking helping us throughout. So I'd like to invite Pranjit Saikia, sir, to highlight a few insights of the program. Sir, please.
Thank you, Padmakshi. Actually, I could hardly listen what Abhinika Madam said, because my whole laptop screen is full with different things. Whatever I have listened, I think the finest presentation I have ever heard on museum and its all and its importance. Respected our principal sir, respected our resource person Avantika Parakhar Madam, Honorable HOD, Department of History, my dear coordinator Dr. Padmakshi, and assistant coordinator Kinamani, and my colleagues of our college, and dear participants. I'm pretty sure that the participants are very benefited from the presentation of Antika. He has put light on some important aspects of museology, and how it should be preserved, or what is the importance of museum in a society. I think our participants will benefit from here. But I just like to say one thing only, that IQAC coordinator of IQAC, I'd like to request Avantika Madam kindly to associate with us for further upgradation or further improvement of our museum, so that we can establish it much scientifically. Therefore, if it is possible for Madam, you kindly organize some workshop or like those like things, so that our students or the people of our locality can be enlightened for preservation of their historical things. In this regard, IQAC is all set to help you or the department if they take such initiative. I, being the IPSC coordinator, I can assure for that. I hope this thing will materialize by the department in near future. And I'm pretty sure that under the leadership of HOD Madhurjo Mondo sir, and with the support of all his colleagues, Tinamani, Padmaksi, Dijenda, and others, other faculties of the department, they will establish this museum in much better way with the support of Avantika Madam. So I think I don't like to say much on this issue because there may be question answering session. So with these words, seeking your help once again, Madam, from your side to upgrade or further develop our museum, I would like to conclude my short speech. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Well, I could see the chat boxes by now. We have a question from the head of the Department of History, Dumduma College, Madhurjo sir, to Avantika. Are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Yeah. What steps should be taken by the students to engage in museum and archival sites? Okay. What steps can be taken?
See, if you have to associate, like the site is coming up, it is, I think we can unmute this guy, Abdul Quddus. He is in some restaurant, I guess.
Yes.
Mute this guy, Abdul Quddus. Okay. So when the site is the site work comes up, it is basically associated with the archaeology. So if you want to directly work in the archaeological sites, you have to contact with that our archaeology department, and then you can take up your students groups and everything. And apart from that, we have in our museums particularly, and in the archive also, we have got some internship program, where students from history background or cultural studies background, they can come or they can write to us. They can write either to me in my mail ID, or like we have got our website. You can write, and our email ID is assamstatemuseum@gmail.com. That's quite easy. assamstatemuseum@gmail.com. You can write to our museum, then you can apply for the internship. It's of course unpaid internship, but you can work there for some continuous process, ongoing projects and all. And it's, I think, for 1 month. And apart from that, in the district museum, in district levels, we provide some unpaid internship, 3 months, 6 months, but they're unpaid. We provide unpaid internships where students can come and they can learn by hand how the museum runs. And if students of your department are interested, they can write to us that they can come for internship.
There is actually, this is also a personal interest to me, Avantika. Can you tell the students about the job opportunities, because they are very and you can understand the constraints a child has to choose a career. So I think you should highlight something on the job opportunity aspects about taking up a course in museum.
Okay.
And there is another question.
Okay.
What should be the qualifications for an internship? Is there any definite qualification, I guess? Also, can you just pinpoint on those?
Okay. When the qualification of internship is concerned, we basically prefer to students who are undergoing master level of study, because in graduation level it becomes a little bit harder for the students to understand the research content, how to proceed and how to go ahead with the research. It becomes a little difficult for the students. So we'll prefer to students who have got a master in if they have got history or some cultural studies, they are doing their masters, they can come to our museums. If somebody is doing, their masters in archaeology, they can go to the archaeology department for internship. And even for anthropology students also, we encourage, because we have got our anthropology departments. And apart from that, there are some particular students we got those requests who have worked from completely different discipline, maybe science or economics or like that, but due to their personal interest, they are doing some projects or something like that. And after that, they come, they approach us for to conduct their studies or to research and to learn how to do research in our museum. So even the scope for that, that is also there. So those students who are interested, they can directly write to us. It's basically you have to write, then we will, and along with that, attach your CV. And if you have got some work experience or like some projects you are undergoing, you are doing, so just write about that, then we will decide and we'll let you know. That we means the museum authority. And then that, as Padmakshi ma'am has asked me about the job opportunity, of course, that when you do some career is the utmost significance for all the students. So there are two types of engagement, I'll say. One is government, one is private. So in right now, that government, the state, our cultural affairs department, under it comes that that our museum, archaeology, library, and these small directorates. So those students with these backgrounds, they are directly recruited by the government in this museum, in state museum, or like, you know, government museums. And apart from that, we have got some historical and antiquarian study department. So there are also students with this background, they are required. And apart from that, there are some several private museums. In Assam, in Northeast, that of course the number is a little bit smaller, but outside Assam, there are lots and lots of private museums or like museum-like organizations which recruit students with this background. And then if somebody wants to go abroad, like outside India, then museum and archaeology, museology and archaeology are the most significant, highly paid, and very interesting, very demanded career opportunities. So people can earn huge amount of money if they want to go abroad. And there's a scholarship facility. If some student want to pursue master degree or PhD degree outside India in museology or archaeology, then there are different universities are there. Even Oxford has got a particular scholarships and funding facility for the students who want to pursue a career in museology. They can, and those advertisements, they annually comes up in the concerned websites. Students can browse the websites and they can get the details. And apart from that, there are scholarships like Fulbright scholarship, and one is Nehru Trust scholarship, and where that some certain amount of money is provided to them to conduct a study, even some short-term studies like 6 months, 8 months, and scholarships are there on also to, you know, for that short period. So just it's everything is in the internet, and you want to, yeah, the students can browse and download, and the process is very simple. You just apply, and after the interview is there, and if you clear the interview, then you can go.
Well, thank you, Abhandika. We hope everyone is clear now about the prospects and aspects of getting into museum science, yeah, studying museology. So now moving on to the last part of this program, I now would formally, for the Thanksgiving ritual, I invite Tina Mani to kindly deliver the vote of thanks. Tina.
Thank you, ma'am. Once again, good afternoon to all. This is my privilege on behalf of the organizing team to have been asked to offer the vote of thanks for the national webinar on mapping traditional museums in contemporary times. As assistant coordinator, I would like to formally convey my gratitude to the efforts of many people in making it a success. First, I take this opportunity to thank our principal, Dr. Prakash Suti Borthakur sir, to have been as an inspiration throughout. You have been our encouragement, sir. Thank you, Dr. Rinjumani Sharma ma'am, vice principal, for being with us today. My humble and deep sense of appreciation goes to our resource person, Mrs. Avantika Parasar, district museum officer, for readily accepting our invitation and sharing her own experiences with us. We are indeed privileged to have you amidst us and for enlightening us with your commendable talk on the subject. I thank Mr. Madhvijya Mohanta sir, head of the Department of History, for encouraging us and being the source of inspiration. Also, we'd like to render our heartfelt thanks to other faculty members in the department for their appreciating involvement throughout. I convey my special thanks to the IQAC coordinator of the college, Dr. Pranjit Saikya sir, for being instrumental in making this webinar a success, and also the IQAC team for their cooperation. Mr. Samrat Jay, for giving us all possible technical support online. Your help was truly a respite in this pandemic time. I would also like to take this opportunity to thank my colleague from the Department of English, Ms. Simi Deka, for taking care of the certificates to be given to the participants hereafter. Next, I would like to thank the entire Dumduma College Teaching Fraternity for giving us the moral boost to organize this webinar. I cannot here thank enough my colleague and the coordinator of the webinar, Dr. Padmakshi Kakoti ma'am, for her relentless efforts in making this webinar a successful one. Thank you, Ba, for being the inspiration. Last but not the least to mention is the enormous number of participants from across the country and elsewhere for your passion, listening, and cooperation. Without your kind presence in the webinar, we could not have accomplished what we had dreamed for. Thank you all. I'm sure the webinar has left diverse implications on many new areas which are yet to be explored and experienced. Once again, thank you one and all. Stay safe. Over to you, Padmakshi ma'am.
Thank you, Tina, for this wonderful vote of thanks. Thank you. So finally, the time has come to wind up. I'm hopeful we all had a very fruitful and wonderful session with Mrs. Avantika Parashar. And we have wonderful memories also to take back home with museums. And with this, I thank one and all for being present with us and for your patient listening throughout. Wish you all a happy, safe, and healthy life ahead. Good day.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.